Right. Well, thank you for organizing this wonderful get-together. I've learned so much from my colleagues. So the question that I'm addressing today is, what determines an authentic experience? And I believe the most authentic experience would be an in-person meeting with the artist. Shake his or her hand, look them in the eye, ask them everything you wanted to know. The problem that we face at the Thomas Cole National Historic Site and all of our sites is that the artist died, in our case in 1848. So I don't know about you, but when I visit the home of a famous person, it's always a bit disappointing that he or she's not there. His art, however, is everywhere. Every major museum in the US has a Cole painting or two. And last year, the Met in New York City and here, the National Gallery in London, teamed up to do a big show. So it might surprise you that this is what his home looked like in the year 2000. His porch was too unsafe to walk on. His old studio still stood, but it was still in ruins. And his new studio, a building that he himself designed, was completely gone, demolished in the 1970s. The property was originally about 100 acres, but we were down to about 5. So given all of these realities, how could we create an authentic experience? The word authentic, according to Webster, actually has 3 somewhat distinct meanings. First, it means real. We yearn for the real thing. We want to walk on the actual floorboards where the famous person walked, touch the same stair railing, see the same view. This is essentially the starting point for all historic sites. It's the real place where history occurred. But let's unpack that for a minute. Those floorboards on the porch are not the actual wood that Thomas Cole trod upon. But of course, the originals rotted to soggy splinters 100 years ago. What about that view? Well, the mountains haven't moved, but the valley has become a village. So we've masked that with trees. When you walk down the gravel path, are your feet crunching on the very stones from 1815? Of course not. We replenish that gravel every spring. So, what is real? I would venture to say that we are all recreating the real thing as best we can. The second meaning of authentic is something factual, supported by unquestionable evidence. In 2000, a group of local volunteers made the house structurally sound, filled it with antiques, and started giving tours. When I first arrived, yes, that's me in 2003, the parlor had lamps from the 1890s, an oriental carpet from the 20th century, and draperies from last week. It also had a few other things that Thomas Cole surely never had, including a piano and an artificial Christmas tree. But what did we have to go on? There were no photographs of the interiors from Cole's lifetime. Clearly, we were missing some facts. The third kind of authenticity is sincerity. A little different. You can be real and factual and still not true to your own character. We wanted to present Thomas Cole's true nature, his authentic self. No pretensions. This darling lady delighted visitors with her stories of playing in the yard with Thomas Cole's great-granddaughter. It was real and factual. But did people come from all over the world to learn about Thomas Cole's great-granddaughter? All of our docents had a list of facts about Thomas Cole, but they instinctively knew that our visitors wanted to hear stories. What about our restoration story? All of our docents wanted to tell that story. I once overheard a docent tell a group of visitors that Thomas Cole died from lead poisoning from his paints. It's a great story. Unfortunately, it meets none of the criteria for authenticity. I would characterize the next 10 years as a massive fact-finding operation. We did a historic landscape report and were informed that the property was a working farm, not a Victorian garden, and the lovely roses and wisteria all had to go. We commissioned a study of the archives and found that there were 14 people living in this four-bedroom house during Cole's lifetime. We did a furnishings and finishes report and found out that Cole did not live in a humble farmhouse, as you see the foyer here, with white walls and painted floorboards. But instead, he had created a high-style, brightly patterned interior world. This is after the restoration. And during the paint analysis, we found this strange, mysterious patch of something. And it turns out that Cole had a habit of painting on the walls. So by the year 2010, we had the real place and lots of facts. But how do you turn this into a sincere presentation for the visitor? We decided to find out what everyone else was doing. So we set off on benchmarking trips. And unfortunately, we didn't have international travel in our budget at the time, but I'm thrilled to add these sites in the UK now to our list. I'll share with you a few inspiring examples that directly influenced the decisions that we made. The Tenement Museum in New York City, for example, brings out the hard times of immigrant families from a century ago. But what made their hardship real to me was holding a copy of the child's death certificate in my hands. The little girl had died at the age of 3. The lesson we took away was that primary sources are powerful. They prove that your story is real. At the Ronald Reagan Museum in California, you don't just hear about the president, you get to be the president. This is my staff educator at the time at the podium. And look, Jimmy Carter is applauding for her. The lesson is that we don't want to stand outside and watch history. We want to participate. At Monticello, the home of Thomas Jefferson, there was a beautiful recreation of the historic kitchen. But what made it magical was an audio recording of someone cooking there, banging a pot or a pan, and humming softly to herself. The lesson we took is, bring back the missing people. We want to feel as if the artist has just stepped in, not out. And at the Theodore Roosevelt inaugural site, this is in Buffalo, New York, so it's a bit of a hike, but this ordinary parlor was transformed into the scene of a riveting historical event by the addition of an audio of Roosevelt's emergency inauguration that actually took place in this room when President McKinley was shot. The lesson is we need to tell what actually happened in our rooms. The rooms are not the story. They are the stage set for the story. So here's what we took away from our many visits. First, how do we narrow down the list of the many stories that we could tell? The best experiences were those that told a focused story. So after a lot of meetings and revisions and discussions and controversy, we agreed on the big idea that we would immerse visitors into Thomas Cole's world so that they may obtain access to the mind of the artist, gain insights into his art, and experience a new understanding of the profound connection between American culture then and now. It was kind of a mouthful, so we created a graphic. And this is helpful on an almost daily basis. I was asked the other day why we do not, for example, have concerts on the lawn. And I said, a concert does not do this. Second, we rejected the either-or of historic restoration versus technology and decided to combine these types of displays that are traditionally kept separate. So at the same time that we were restoring the historic decor, we were also putting into the rooms, here's the original carpet and some of the painted decoration that we found. We're also putting into the rooms these technological devices to help us tell the stories of what took place there. And this is one of our team members seeing if we could hide a camera inside a frame and project an image down onto a piece of paper on the table. Third, we decided to get rid of all the velvet ropes and allow people to come all the way into all the rooms. Fourth, we had to figure out a way to bring in the art. Here's one of Thomas Cole's most famous paintings, The Oxbow, at the Met. Sadly, they're not going to give it back to us. So, what are our options? First, we are featuring our own objects in an exhibition all about the creative process. We made lemonade out of lemons. We have small things, let's call it the creative process. Two, do you remember this lost building? Well, we've reconstructed it, and we filled the inside with a state-of-the-art gallery. Now we can borrow works from all over the world. Third, we decided that we would use both reproductions and projections where they are needed. In the West Parlor, we used high-quality, actual-size reproductions. Here is the West Parlor with our own small paintings where they never would have been. And this is the parlor with the reproductions. It just wasn't Thomas Cole's parlor without his paintings. In the East Parlor, we projected the paintings into frames so that they appear to be paintings, but then the paintings begin to move and tell a story. Lastly, we decided to use Thomas Cole's own words to speak directly to the visitor without an intermediary, no narrator, no expert commentary. When Cole says, "The copper-hearted barbarians are cutting all the trees down in the beautiful valley. The most noble scenes are made desolate, and oftentimes with a wantonness scarcely credible in a civilized nation." People can relate. People can make their own interpretations. It's as close as we can get to meeting the artist in person. I'll play a video that shows the storytelling installations in action. And this was a video made by the firm we worked with called Second Story.
Before, this was what I call a velvet rope tour. Informative, interesting, but not really engaging. Thanks to Second Story, we have now got this immersive, thought-provoking experience in these two parlors. In the East Parlor, you're in a very cinematic experience, totally unexpected. That sort of takes your breath away and puts you into the mind of Thomas Cole. In the West Parlor, as you move around, the furniture comes to life. The marriage of the authentic and the technological are thrilling. I think one would be hard-pressed to find somebody who isn't swept up into the world of Thomas Cole and into his mind. And that is spectacular.
Thank you.